Welcome, everyone. this is the presentation for the Mini Marine Biologist certificate. So I'm really glad that you guys are all here. We're here to celebrate National Whale and Dolphin Watch Week, which is an annual thing that Sea Watch Foundation does with the help of many, many, many dedicated enthusiasts, citizen scientists, and people who care about the marine environment, especially around the UK, and want to help us conserve it. So hopefully we will have a nice little snapshot together of the different animals you can find in Cardigan Bay, which is in West Wales. And then there will be an activity pack afterwards, which I'll send you guys, and you'll also get a little certificate of completion. And there'll be a little bit of time at the end if you guys have any questions. Okay. So this morning, we are going to have a look at what's in the Welsh Sea. We're going to meet the mammals of Cardigan Bay. We're going to do a little bit about how to spot dolphins and cetaceans and what you guys need to look out for. We're going to tell you about some of our adoptable dolphins. And then there is a little bit of arts and crafts at the end, which you guys can do in your own time, but which I'll just talk you through as well. So let's dive in, shall we? So yeah, so Sea Watch Foundation, as my colleague said, is a marine conservation charity. So we work to protect the whales, dolphins and porpoises along all across the UK, so around the British coast and also Ireland. And we collaborate with other charities to do this as well. Now, our flagship project is actually the Cardigan Bay conservation project, in which we actually study the bottlenose dolphins in Cardigan Bay, which is really exciting. And it is also how we are particularly able to communicate to everyone exactly what is going on with the cetaceans in the UK and how we can keep track of what potential threats there are, when the populations are doing healthy, and what conservation efforts actually are working to help us protect those animals and live sustainably alongside them. So I'm just going to play a quick video for you guys, if you'd like to see. This is just some of our bottlenose dolphins that we have taken footage of while out on our surveys on the boats. Okay, so that just gives you guys a little snapshot of some of the most exciting encounters we get with the bottlenose dolphins in Cardigan Bay. And with that, we are on a special research vessel, and that means that we are allowed to stay with the dolphins a little bit longer than some of the tourist boats, but we are still very careful to stick within the marine code of conduct just to make sure we're not disturbing them. And as you guys may have seen, the bottlenose dolphins actually like riding that pressure wave in front of the boat, so we can get some really good footage, which then we can share with everyone and also use to identify the dolphins for them to later. So why Cardigan Bay? Cardigan Bay, as you guys can see here, it's one of the largest bays in the British Isles. It measures over 100 kilometres from the mouth, so you can see the dotted line on that map. And it's got a shallow and often sandy bottom, and that means it's actually a really good safe place for females to have their young, which we call calves. Now, Sea-Watch Foundation has actually collaborated and uses its data to assist in setting up two special areas of conservation within Cardigan Bay. And those are particularly focused on protecting the bottlenose dolphin, the harbour porpoise, and the Atlantic grey seal, because we also get grey seals here. Now, because it's fairly shallow, there are also fewer of the large predatory sharks. We don't usually get orca killer whale coming in, and that means that the bay itself is seen as particularly safe from the dolphin's point of view, and especially the bottlenose dolphin. They are one of the biggest, the top of the food chain here. So they're very, very confident. And that means that they are happy to come into the shore, even into the harbour sometimes. So we see a lot of them around here. So, what is in Cardigan Bay? We're going to have a look now at some of the different animals. But just before that, I'm just going to talk about the actual ocean. So the oceans are huge masses of water. They continuously flow around the world. They don't have any of the boundaries or divisions that we have on land, because obviously when you get to the edge of the land, you end up in the sea, but the sea continues all the way around the different land masses, so it's all connected. And we have currents that circulate the globe, and they bring the cold water and sometimes warm water elsewhere. So Cardigan Bay itself receives water, receives the currents from the North Atlantic. And one of that actually includes the Gulf Stream, which brings warm water all the way from the Gulf of Mexico. And so we have a lot of different sort of sources of water coming into the bay. And that means we also get a lot of different fish here. So, fishy business. We find many, many different types of fish, and because of the special areas of conservation, they are very abundant here. So some of our larger fish are like the predatory fish, like the small spotted cat shark that you can see here. With those, there are also angel sharks we get here, who are critically endangered and also protected by the bottlenose dolphins special area of conservation, and also the thresher shark, which has a very interesting feeding technique and can often be seen breaching, jumping right out of the water. Now we also have various flatfish in Cardigan Bay, including the thornback ray that you can see on the right, and the blonde ray, and also the turbot, which you can see on the left. These are very, very masterful camouflage artists. And they are flat and they lie on the sandy bottom, and that helps them escape notice by predators. We also are lucky enough along the shores to actually find things which we call mermaid's purses. And you can see the middle photo here is the mermaid's purse of a ray species. That was found on a local beach in the UK, on Dolo Beach, and that is the egg case of a ray, but you also get shark egg cases as well, and we're lucky enough to have a few on display here in the education hub. So these are normally found from the smaller species like of shark and ray that we get around here, and they have these kind of long appendages which they use to, once they're laid out into the water column, they float along and then they catch on rock or seaweed, and that just anchors in there while the young shark and ray develops and gets ready to hatch. and it stops it floating around the water column and potentially ending up in an unsuitable habitat or being eaten by some of the larger predatory fish, other predatory fish. So if you see one of those on the beach, you may now know what it's called, a mermaid's purse, and what it's from. It's from a shark or a ray. We also get different sorts of spiky fish in Cardigan Bay. So the long-spined sea scorpion is on the left, and that's a very, very interesting looking fish. And it is not great to stand on, so it's very important not to touch these animals. But they are, as you can see, masters of disguise, and they have these defense mechanisms in case predators come at them from above. The weaver fish as well is one that we see a lot around Cardigan Bay and also around Minke itself. And they have these little spines which stick up on the top of their back, and they also have a venom in them. So be really careful when you're wandering around if you're potentially snorkeling rather than kind of sticking to the landlocked pools. And sometimes you get multiple of these traits together, such as the sunfish. Now, the sunfish is an incredibly strange looking fish. It is round and flat, and it has these two big fins, as you can see, which waggle along as it swims along, and it swims along like that, almost like a swimming head. And then it also feeds on jellyfish, so it's what we call a jellyvore. Now, the sunfish has a really interesting behaviour at the surface, in which we believe it is a mutualism between the sunfish itself and seabirds. But the sunfish are often known to actually come and they flip over onto their sides at the surface, and they let the sun warm them, and then they bask in the sun, but they also flap their fins at the surface, making lots and lots of splashing noises. And that actually attracts seabirds, like these seagulls you can see here. And they come up to the sunfish and they actually eat all the little ectoparasites, which are in the actual skin of the sunfish. All these little parasites, which the sunfish doesn't want to have, but also can't remove itself because obviously it can't twist around because it's quite a unflexible shape. And so the birds actually get a free meal and the sunfish gets a spa day while also enjoying those wonderful vitamin D inducing rays from the sun at the surface of the water. Now, because we get so many jellyfish in Cardigan Bay, we do get sunfish here, and one was actually started off the fish factory off Minke last week, so hopefully there'll be some more this summer. But now we're going to actually look at the jellyfish themselves, because obviously without them the sunfish wouldn't be here. So we get five main species of jellyfish in Cardigan Bay. There are others as well, but the five ones we see most commonly are the ones I'll go through now. Now, one is the moon jellyfish, and they're just starting to get a time now when there will be lots and lots and lots of moon jellyfish around. We call them a bloom of jellyfish. So it's sort of their breeding time now in Cardigan Bay, and they have a really interesting life cycle. So I'm sure you guys have seen the sort of the blobbiness of, the jellyfish body. If you've been out on a boat at sea, you might even have seen them washed up on the shore. But that's actually only the adult of the jellyfish. When they are ready to breed, they produce these larvae. We call it a larva, and that settles at the bottom, almost like a little seed, except this is from an animal rather than a plant. And then they settle at the bottom and they grow into what we call a polyp, which is like a little plant, like a little plant sprouting. And they are anchored at the bottom of the sea, and they have these tentacles which help them feed. But then once they're actually ready to move on to their next stage, once they have eaten enough and built up enough energy reserves, they go under a big change. They lose those tentacles which they were feeding with, and they can't feed anymore at this stage. They basically go through a process known as strobilation. And so the top segments peel off and float away as tiny little, we call them ephyra, and they actually morph and grow into a jellyfish, each one. So from that little polyp, there's lots and lots of layers, and they all individually peel off into lots and lots of tiny jellyfish, and then they mature into the adult jellyfish. So it's a really interesting life cycle, especially for an animal rather than a plant, because we normally think of this sort of behavior is more like a plant. So this is the moon jelly, and you can recognize them normally. They're translucent and they have sort of four rings, more colorful rings within, visible on the bell or the umbrella, the curvy bit at the top of the jellyfish. Now, the compass jellyfish are what we've actually been seeing most commonly around in Newquay this last month, because they've gone through their bloom in July. Now, these guys are really pretty and they have these really long tentacles. They're called compass jellies because, as you can see, the top of that curved part, the bell or the umbrella, it's got these dark lines radiating out, almost like a sun, and that looks a bit like the face, the compass, the face of a compass, and that's why they're called a compass jelly. Now, these have a nasty sting, so if you do see one, don't touch it, but they are lovely to watch swimming along, and even you can see that if the tentacles are reaching out and actually touching the floor of the seabed, then you can actually see them feeding like that. The third species is the blue jellyfish. These are usually relatively small, but they can get to a larger size, as you can see on the left. But at the moment, we're seeing mostly small ones about this big, and they're very bright blue when you see them in the water. They're obviously a bit more see-through on the land, as you can see on the right. And they also have a nasty sting, so do watch out for them, but they are very beautiful to see in the water. Now, the lion's mane jellyfish is my favorite personally. It can get very large. You do see small ones as well, but it can get very large. And these colors that you can see are fantastic. They are absolutely stunning. And sadly, the one on the left, on the right, has actually beached itself. Well, it's become stranded, but the one on the left is a full, fully functional living lion's mane jellyfish. And these are a little bit rarer to see, but we do occasionally see them. Finally, the barrel jellies. Now, these are the guys who we had a huge bloom of in Cardigan Bay in the end of May and the early part of June. These are the ones which get really, really big. They often a peachy kind of pinky color. You can get blue ones as well though. They almost look like a cornflower underneath, as you can see here, and they can get bigger than a human. So they can get absolutely huge. And they are don't tend to sting as badly as the other four species. The most you get, you feel a bit of a nettle rash, like you if you brush up against a nettle leaf, a little stinging nettle. And that's only from actually touching the tentacles, because the bell of the jellyfish, all of them do not actually sting. It's only those tentacles which have these particular stinging cells in them, which we call nematocysts. And now we can't mention jellyfish without mentioning the other star of the jellyfish world in Cardigan Bay, which is the leatherback turtle. And these turtles can get incredibly large as well. And they come to Cardigan Bay. They are a rare sight, but we do get one or two sightings every year. And they come to feed on the jellyfish, especially the barrel jellies, because like the sunfish, they absolutely love jellyfish. They're what we call jellyvores. And unlike us, who get stung by jellyfish, they seem to be absolutely fine with them. Now, what we should remember about turtles is that while they are marine animals, they are reptiles. So like species of fish, and unlike mammals, they are what we call ectotherms, or they have cold blood. So normally they don't get very much energy unless they actually are in a warm place or use the sun to warm up. That's why we see turtles, but also kind of lizards and snakes on land basking in the sun. So these are the only turtles that we tend to get in Cardigan Bay because the water is so cold there most of the time. But the other species stick to warmer climates. We're really lucky that the leatherbacks are able to withstand that colder temperature, and so they still come. And one was actually sighted off Fish Guard last month, so hopefully we'll have a few more sightings of them this summer. If you do see any, we would love to hear about it. Okay. They actually also do unlike the other turtles, they are able to regulate their own body temperatures, which is why they're not in those tropical areas. And also the ridges that you can see, why they're called, well, they're called leatherbacks because their backs look quite leathery, but those ridges are how you particularly identify leatherback turtle if you're in an area where there are more than just the leatherbacks around. So I think it might be time to meet the mammals if you guys are up for that. So the mammals in Cardigan Bay are many, as well as humans. First, we have the grey seal. Now, the grey seal is what we call a pinniped. It's the only species of seal we get in Cardigan Bay itself. And they do have their pups here as well, the little fluffy white pups. Now, the Latin, the species name for a grey seal is called a Halicurus grippus, and that actually means hook-nosed sea pig, which I think is a little bit unfortunate and a bit mean, because they are the largest type of seal in the UK, and they do have quite a long Roman nose. You can't see as well from this one because it's actually a female, but the males have a wonderful Roman nose profile. But they don't, to me, they look very sweet and they are an important part of the ecosystem, but obviously the people who named them thought they were a bit on the ugly side. So they're known for their grey colour, and they also are particularly good at the pose that you can see here, which is called bananaing. So when they're at rest, they will lie down, but they'll have their head sticking up and they'll have their tail sticking up. So they're actually shown in the shape of a banana. And so they often adopt this pose when they're resting out of the water. We call it falling out, because they have to work really hard to haul their bodies out of the water because they are pretty heavy, bulky animals on land. And this is their main resting pose on land. And then in the sea, when they're resting, you can just see the little head poking up and the head just sticks up out of the water. The rest of the body is hanging in the water column like having a pencil, doing a pencil jump. And we call that bottle because they are like a bottle floating in the water just with the hair sticking out. Now, next we're going to move on to the cetaceans. So cetacean is a scientific name for the group of marine mammals dolphins, whales, and porpoises all make up. And here in Cardigan Bay, the harbour porpoise that you can see here is the smallest and relatively shy, but one of the most common species seen because they actually live in Cardigan Bay and they live in the coastal area. Now, they're quite a small animal. They get up to 1.8 metres, but normally they are about 1.5 meters long, which is, it sounds quite big to us, but compared to some of the other cetaceans that we get here, it's not that big at all. They're very shy. They go around in small groups, maybe two or three animals, or like a family group, as you can see on the right, the smaller one behind the larger one, that's the young one, that's a calf. They stay in the slightly deeper waters rather than coming actually into the harbours because they want to stay away from the bottlenose dolphins who might bully them. And they're also sometimes referred to as mere swine, which means sea pigs. So they're another species which has a rather unfortunate name, but are rather an unassuming and sweet species. And they feed on the smaller fish, like the sand eels, which we have in abundance in Cardigan Bay. And that's why they are one of the species that is particularly focused on for marine protection in Cardigan Bay. But another species, which is a little bit more flashy, is the Rousseau's dolphin. These guys are found out in deeper waters, and they like feeding on really squishy prey like octopus and squid and cuttlefish. Mostly it is that group called the cephalopods, which they feed on, but they will eat some fish as well, some small fish like cod. They look very interesting, as you can see. They're actually born with a relatively blank, single-coloured skin marking, but they actually have very, very, very rough play sessions. So a lot of these squiggles that you see on them are actually scars, and they're actually made by the teeth of the other Rousseau's dolphins. They play with each other in these big, quite rough and tumble socialisation groups, and they have a lot of fun, but it does mean that they get a lot of scars on their body, which doesn't seem to upset them at all. So the older they get, the more scars they accumulate, and the very old ones can actually look almost completely white because they look like they've been just coloured in completely all over by all that scarring. And they are about similar size to the bottlenose dolphin, so they can get up to 4 meters long, which is very, very large. And like I say, they don't come into shore as often, so you tend to have to go out a little way on a boat if you're going to see them. But they are living in Cardigan Bay and feeding on that, those squishy organisms, which we also enjoy eating, and things like calamari ourselves. The stars of Cardigan Bay are the bottlenose dolphins, as I'm sure you guys are aware. They're pretty much the dolphin that everyone thinks of if you just say dolphin, because they are the ones that are often seen in the social media and in books and in documentaries, but also they're ones which have often been on display in marine parks as well, and there have been various films made about them. Now, the bottlenose dolphins here are very abundant. We have actually catalogued over 400 individuals, and we have a look at their dorsal fin, which is how we actually identify those individuals. We look at the little scars and the little notches, the shape, the patterns of any colours on there. They get some like white scarring sometimes, or even birthmarks. And so we keep track of them like that. So they are semi-resident in Cardigan Bay. Actually, you can see behind me on the screen, we have Cardigan Bay up here, and they go up north to Anglesey, up to the top northernmost part of Wales in the winter to feed on fish in the deeper waters there. But in the spring and summer and autumn, they are in Cardigan Bay, and we enjoy our time studying them and helping to protect them. A minke whale is the most common type of larger bodied animal which we see in Cardigan Bay. Now, these guys actually have been nicknamed stinky minkies because apparently they are quite difficult to see because they are not that large as far as the baleen whales go, but they are very, very strong smelling when they breathe out. So that blow, the sort of the mist of water that you see above the sea when you see a whale coming out to breathe out and then take a nice big breath of air, that is very smelly from a minke whale. And so often researchers will actually say if the downwind of a minke whale, you will be able to identify it even if you can't actually see it because you get that waft. They are relatively small for the baleens, like I say, and they tend to visit the British coasts between May and October time. And in Cardigan Bay particularly, that's when they're around because that is when all the nutrients from the Irish Sea are allowing the fish species and the invertebrate species to breed and multiply. And that means there's lots and lots and lots of fish and food around for them. They have a relatively tall sickle-shaped fin, so it's just very curved over, and it's sort of two-thirds of the way along their body, along the back. So there will be a breath, and then there'll be a gap. You won't see anything else, and there'll be a little fin, a little further back, and they are dark grey to black in colour. So, as you can imagine, they're not that easy to spot, but they have a very characteristic smelly glow. So, where have cetaceans come from? Remember, cetaceans are whales, dolphins, and porpoises, so they're that group of marine mammals. So when the dinosaurs roamed the earth, there was little room for mammals. So most were small, shrew-like. They often came out at night, but the extinction of the dinosaurs 65 million years ago made room for mammals much bigger, and that they were able to expand into lots of different habitats and eat the greens, eat the omnivores who eat other animals' eggs, eat a bit of meat, eat a bit of vegetable, eat a bit of insect. And others also became carnivores. Now, the dolphin's ancestor did live on land. You can see here, it's the Pakistidae. This is the direct ancestor of the dolphin, and the species we most commonly known as the Pakistidae, and they were predatory, and they were on land, and they had fur, as you can see. They are mammals. And when the extinction of the dinosaur, also dinosaurs and the other species that were living alongside the dinosaurs in that particular Jurassic world, when that extinction took place, there was also a, what we call a niche, an opening, an opportunity for many of the mammal species to expand and actually return to the water. And so that's what Pakistidae did, is they eventually returned to the sea. They're still mammals. So dolphins are mammals. They have warm blood. They give birth to live young. They give their babies milk, which nourishes them. And that's what they feed on as soon as they're born. And that allows them to grow big and big and strong very fast. And it also gives them a bit of protection against some of the bugs, some of the bacteria and fungus and viruses in their environment, which they get from their mums. And they do breathe air as well. They still breathe air, but they move back to the ocean to live. What you can see here in this diagram is comparing our arm, our human arm, with that of a dolphin. You can see the different colours actually show you where those bones came from. This are the same bone, they have the same source, but they have changed, what we call adapted, as we have evolved on land while the dolphin evolved in water. So while our bones are long and thinner, and we have these long finger bones called the phalanges and the metacarpals, which allow us to be very dexterous, we can grab things, we can pick things up, we can bite, we can open things. The dolphin's bones have become a lot more squashed, a lot thicker and squashed, and that has and they're in the shape of a pointed fin, and that has allowed them to withstand those pressures in the water of being used as a flipper to guide and to change direction and to generally make the dolphin able to move around in the marine environment as it needs to and be very, very acrobatic when necessary underwater. So there are actually two types of whale. I'm sure you've heard people say whales, dolphins, porpoises. And you might sometimes have wondered why a killer whale, which is like a big dolphin, is still called a whale. And that's because the word whale doesn't actually mean anything scientifically, except for a large marine mammal. So how we as scientists actually categorize, distinguish between the different ways of living within the cetaceans is that we call baleen whales Mysticeti and toothed whales Odontoceti. So this is an odontocete. Now all dolphins are odontocetes. So is the killer whale, the pilot whale, the sperm whale, and the bottlenose whale, and also the porpoises. And you can see in this anatomy that the dorsal fin is up in the center of the body. That's for most of them, that is true. And they have a single blowhole rather than two nostrils like we have. They've just got one opening to breathe in and breathe out through, and that's up on the top of their head. Now they have an enlarged melon, which is what we call the forehead of the animal. And they use that in a special skill, which we call echolocation. And that is like a sixth sense that they use to scan the environment. It's like a sort of a biological sonar. It's similar to what bats use. And they send out a series of clicks, which are made by a little air squeezing structure within their blowhole. And it sends out little clicks, which then gets channeled through the melon in their forehead. And that goes out into the environment and it bounces back from the environment, from the fish and from the other dolphins or whales, from the sea floor, from the surface of the sea. So they get a big picture, which then gets transmitted through their lower jaw, through specialized, specially adapted lower jawbone and into their ear. And so they actually, as well as hearing normally, they can hear using this other sense, and that is how they build up a picture of their environment. Now, it's only the odontocetes which have this. So the baleen whales, like the blue whale, and the humpback, and the minke whale, they aren't able to do this. The other, and the, obviously the main, the biggest difference is that the odontocetes have individual teeth. That's why they're also called the toothed whales. Now, because of this, and because they are of their size and the prey they go after individual animals. So they will chase a fish or a squid or an octopus, or in the case of the killer whale, sometimes another marine mammal or bird. But they go after individual animals, and that's why they need this extra sense as well, to really help them actually travel around and locate their prey. Now we're going to look at the mysticetes of the baleen whales. So these are the other species, the other group of animals. There we go. So the mysticetes, are for the most part larger bodied. And they actually have two blowholes up on top of their heads. So the nostrils, which we have. Similar to the dolphin, they are up on the top of the head, but they still have those two nostrils rather than one blowhole like the dolphins. Their dorsal fin is often further back along the back, so sort of two-thirds of the way along the back. And they have this interesting feature underneath their chin called the ventral pleats. And that allows them to, or some of them anyway, to expand their lower jaw, the area behind their lower jaw, and that allows them to gulp in a huge gulp of water at one time. So what they'll do is they will see a group of species of fish or krill or smaller bodied species of prey animal, and they will do a big lunge into it, take a huge gulp of water out of that prey into that mouth, and those ventral pleats expand out, and then they'll use their tongue to push the water back out. And the baleen, which is like, it's made of the same as our fingernails and our hair, it's made of keratin, it's like a big bristly brush, and it lines their jaw. And so as the tongue pushes the water back through, that filters out all the little edible organisms, and so they get stuck within the whale's mouth, and it can then swallow them, and that's how they feed. Other than the toothed whales who go after individual prey animals. Now, we are lucky enough to have some of this baleen at the education hub in Newquay. So if you want to come and actually have a look at what it looks like, what it feels like, you're welcome to come. So there's no place like home. So here off the Welsh coastline, I say, we do study the bottlenose dolphins particularly because they are the ones that are the most common. And our bottlenose gang spend most of their time in Cardigan Bay in the Irish Sea, but they are known as a semi-resident pod because some individuals, in fact the majority of individuals, will travel up north to the area around Anglesey in the winter to find food. They also do occasionally travel further afield, but for the most part they spend the majority of each year, most of each year in Cardigan Bay. We have actually catalogued over 400 individuals in our over 20 years of studying, and we think that they're between 200 and 250 semi-resident in Cardigan Bay at any one year. And if you remember, I said they come here to have their babies. Now, what do we know about bottlenose dolphins here in Cardigan Bay? They are the largest bottlenose dolphins in the world. The bottlenose dolphin as a species is actually very abundant around the world, but they are in different areas rather than having a population all through the different seas. And the ones here, because they have to cope with that cold, cold temperature of the Irish Sea, even in wintertime, they are the largest of those different subspecies of bottlenose. They can get up to 4.5 meters, and they are incredibly fast. They can reach 32 kilometers per hour. So that's a really, really fast speed for an animal that's so big and muscly. And they sleep with half of their brain at a time. Now, for you and me, and for most of the land mammals, we don't have to think about breathing. So if we fall asleep, we breathe still. If we go underwater, we have to focus not to breathe. But obviously for a dolphin, that has to be different because they actually need to not breathe if they are unconscious for whatever reason, because if they're in the water and they breathe in water, then that will be very bad for them and they could drown. So they only sleep with half of their brain at a time, and the other half just is vaguely aware and just make sure that they continue breathing at regular intervals. And so that means that they can not breathe in any water and that they can get enough oxygen while the half of the brain that's off duty is resting. Now, normally you will see them either hanging in the water column, stationary, like just staying still, or they might just be moving along very slowly, very gently in sort of the same direction. And that is usually how we can see if they're sleeping. Now, they do have calves all year round, and they carry a calf in a special part of the female's stomach area called the uterus for 12 months. So that's a huge time. That's a really, really long time for a mum to be pregnant. But because of that, they only have one calf at a time. And like I mentioned earlier, the sixth sense that they use, that only the toothed whales, the baleen whales, use, is called echolocation. And here you can actually see exactly how it works. So you can see this little blue dot within the blowhole. And that is what, it's like a plug, basically. It can be called the monkey plug sometimes. It's quite a funny name. And it basically snaps shut on air and uses air a bit like up, we can do by going to emit sounds into the upper nasal passage. You can see this white area. So that's sort of going up to the blowhole, like our nose goes down to our nostril. And then this melon, this organ within the forehead that makes the dolphins have this bulgy forehead, that focuses the sound out and it bounces off the environment. And then the sound passes through the jaw, through the conducting tissue, and into the inner ear. And that transmits to the brain, and then they get a vision of their environment. And this helps them to socialize, to identify each other as individual animals. They can see who's around them, they can see if it's their friends or not, and then they can see where there might be some food and where there might be danger as well. They can try to track, they can find, look out for predators or for maybe other dolphins who might not be so friendly. And here you can see one of our young, our baby dolphins in Cardigan Bay. This was taken this year by someone called Sarah, who works on the dolphin boat trip company that we partner with. And this one's mum, as you can see, has quite a smooth edge to her dorsal fin. So we don't actually have her catalogued yet, which is really exciting for us. So she's actually a new animal. But these two have been around since May. We've been seeing them regularly, and they are a fantastic pair to be seeing regularly because the baby, the calf, is incredibly playful. And so he has been entertaining us and also entertaining a lot of visitors in his wild environment while his mum is fishing. So how do you spot dolphins? Now, the first thing to think about is dorsal fin. So just because you need to know what you're looking out for. Now, the dorsal fin is tall and spiky. It's curved, and it's a bit similar to a shark fin, but it's sort of curved and elongated a bit, and it kind of tapers out into a point. However, they may only be at the surface for a short amount of time just to actually have a breath. So, all right, it's important to look out for splashes and discharges in the water as well, because sometimes you can just see the place where the dolphin has been, but then it will come up again for another breath in a little while. So at least you know the area you're looking at. So the first thing we'd say to look out for is look out for any disturbance in the water. The second thing is also to look out for any congregations of birds in the sky. So if there are lots of birds circling around in the sky over a patch of sea, especially if you see something like a gannet, like you can see in this photo in the middle, actually diving into the water, that's feeding behavior for those seabirds who also eat fish. And that can often be a sign that dolphins are around as well, because if there's a group of fish, if there's a good area for fishing and the birds are fishing, it's often likely that the dolphins are there too. So first of all, scan the sea for kind of splashes, disturbances in the water or ripples, and then also have a look in the sky for any birds that are around circling. And then finally, you want to look out for this dark shape with a curved pointed fin on the back. Sometimes you may get lucky, they may jump out of the water completely or halfway, which we call breaching, but often it is just that fin. And it's only out for a second or so most of the time, but they do sometimes breathe for several breaths consecutively, one after the other, or they'll still come up in the same area after a couple of minutes. So it's about patience, but it's also about just learning to look at the different animals around and the different footprints on the water, and to use basically all the information around you to help you spot dolphins or whales if they are around. And if they are around, we would love to hear about it, which you can let us know via our website. Now, because we have these dolphins who are in the bay and we're seeing them very regularly, we actually have an adopt a dolphin scheme. And I just wanted to tell you about this because I wanted you to know about some of the individuals that we see most regularly. So we have 7 individuals who we see very, very regularly and who people can choose to actually adopt. And with that, you choose one dolphin. And because we see them so often, we're able to provide a monthly update. So you can basically get a snapshot into what that dolphin's been doing in that month. So who they've been seen with, have they had a baby, have they been fishing, have they been playing, have they been in the harbour, have they been further out to sea? And you can also log into a special part of the adoption website. And then whenever we see them out on surveys, you'll actually be able to see that on the maps. So as well as getting some general information and a cuddly soft toy of a dolphin and posters and identification glass, you get a monthly update on that individual dolphin. And so that's something that we really, really enjoy about the dolphins here, that we see them so often that we can actually allow people who are interested to actually get a snapshot of those individuals and what they're doing on a monthly basis. So one of our adoptable dolphins is Berry, and we've seen her a lot this year. She's a really good mum. We first met her in 2007 with her mum, whose name was Wendy. And she has already had a son called Pip, and her daughter, Luna, is still with her at the moment. But she's actually getting a bit older now. She's no longer a tiny calf. She's over a year and a half old, and between the ages of 2 and 4, dolphin calves wean, they stop drinking their mum's milk and they start being a bit more independent. So she's just starting to get a bit more independent, but Berry is a very, very good mum, and she's very careful not to let her daughter go too near any boats, which could be potentially dangerous to her. So we see Berry a lot, and she likes to come into Newquay Harbour where the boats come out from. And she's also good friends with another adoptable called Ghost, who's another fantastic mum. And Ghost's calf is called Summer. So Berrien Ghost and Summer and Luna form what we call a maternity pod sometimes, some of the time. And that's generally the mums and the little ones going around together. They join up with other groups of dolphins sometimes to socialise, but mostly they are staying, just the four of them, in their day-to-day activities. Tigger is another dolphin, and he is the star of The Magic Dolphin, which is a book written by one of our staff members, Kirsten, who also set up this Adopt a Dolphin scheme. Now, he's a very cheeky dolphin, and he gets into a lot of trouble with Lumpy, whose photo you can see in the right, and Button. And he also has been known to spend a lot of time in the last few years with Frodo and Dumbledore, who are two young adult males who have been doing a lot of prowl riding recently. Now, Tigger was actually a big mama's boy, and his mum, Chris, was such a good mum, and he loved her so much that he didn't leave her for 7 years. So while all his friends were leaving their mums between the age of 3 and 4 years old, he stayed with her for an extra 3 years. And so he's finally now separated from his mum, Chris, and he is getting into all sorts of trouble, he's not in danger. He's just getting up to all sorts of antics in and around Minke and in Cardigan Bay in general. So those are two of our adoptable dogs. Now, I am looking at the time and we are running very short of time now. So what I'm going to suggest is, rather than actually going through the arts and crafts with you guys myself, I'm going to send you an email which has got the downloadable pack with all the instructions in it for the arts and crafts. And then you guys can have a go at making your own binoculars and make a little notebook that you can record any sightings in. And then I'm just going to basically open this up in case you guys have any questions. So congratulations, you've now gained our mini marine biologist certificate. And thank you for taking part. If you're interested in the adoption, then these are the websites, the Adopt a Dolphin website. And we would love you to drop in if you can, if you're passing in Newquay in West Wales anytime at all, really. We're open in the summer months up until October, the end of October. Or you can send us an email and we will be happy to welcome you.